All right, well, it's good to be here with you. Thank you for coming. We talk about apologetics a lot in this group, and we've been together for a while, a lot of us, talking about apologetics, and we talk about Calvinism a lot. We're going to talk about it again tonight, and our church isn't confused by Calvinism. We don't worry about it like I think other churches that are ignoring it do. I also want to thank the pastors that have asked me to speak at their churches on Calvinism. There are people that do want to hear these things that I'm saying about Calvinism. I've been testing them for decades, and you know, I don't think Calvinists are really interested in hearing my arguments. I think they're more interested in just hearing their side bully, or you know, just be intolerant and have no patience. And if they don't hear exactly what they think they want to hear, they freak out. And it's really strange, because in Calvinism, there's so many variations of Calvinism that are accepted amongst themselves. There's charismatic Calvinists, dispensational Calvinists, covenant, presuppositional, classical. There's, you know, just such a variety of Calvinists, but they band together. But if we don't say one thing exactly like Arminius said or something, they freak out, and there's no room for us to, you know, have differences. And I believe that what I bring to the table, because, you know, this has been going on for hundreds of years, and it's been the same thing. You say this, I say that. And I think my debate with James White, he was frustrated because I'm supposed to say this and I'm not doing it. And he's like, why aren't you saying what you're supposed to say? And, you know, we need to start saying other than what we've done for the past hundreds of years. And I believe that's what I bring to the table. And I believe my arguments are solid. And that we need to have permission, if Calvinists can have all of these different hyper-Calvinism, moderate Calvinism, you know, but we have to be held to this one line of accountability. And they have no accountability, but they accept one thing: they don't like us. And they're going to say negative things about us, and I'm kind of sick of it. And so I am going to be continuing to make these videos. I have a lot of videos. My wife was diagnosed with cancer, so I haven't been on YouTube for a long time, but I'm back. My wife's doing good, and things are, I believe, going to be okay. And so I'm also frustrated with some of the things I'm seeing, because they're emboldened, I think, by the bad answers we make, and you know, just the passion they have. You have to give them that. There's a passion that they'll even, you know, go beyond courtesy. And you know, I just, maybe I'm that guy that's willing to go beyond that too if I have to. So we have you know, this thing, this debate just continues on. What we're going to do tonight is look at a video, and this video is just put out 2 days ago, and it was Jeff Durbin, who's a Calvinist that he's very aggressive. He actually has written about me on his blog, and it's written by someone else, actually, but it's Jeff Durbin's blog, and I hold him responsible for the lies that are on that blog. And you need to take it down, or debate me, perhaps. But this video is showing something he put out a couple days ago, and I just would say you drew first blood. I don't know. It's not retaliation, but I want to just use this as an example of the problems we see in Calvinism. Now, what we're going to see, it's a video on the problem of evil, and it talks much about free will. So I think we need to look and hold them accountable for their comments, because their comments are contradictory. You need to understand that Calvinism is circular reasoning. From the very beginnings of, you know, regeneration precedes faith is circular reasoning. It just goes on and on with these contradictions, and I think that they need to be held accountable. They have multiple views of free will, multiple views of sovereignty, multiple views of time, and they're all contradictory views. So they get away with it. And Calvinists just kind of love it, the contradictions, I think. They love the mystery. Appealing to mystery is circular reasoning, a logical fallacy. And all of Calvinism is circular reasoning. So for that reason, it's not true. Sometimes our side does circular reasoning also, but I reject when our side does it too, because I don't believe God uses circular reasoning. But Calvinists like James White admitted in a debate with Stephen Anderson on the King James Only, he admitted Calvinism is circular reasoning. James White always has a caveat why his contradictions are okay. He said his is a circular reasoning that is okay because it can't appeal to anything higher than God. Well, all circular reasoning, most circular reasoning happens in discussions about God. So how is, you know, his acceptable and others aren't? His stuff is always acceptable, no matter how contradictory it is. It's acceptable, but we can't do it. In fact, he corrected Stephen Anderson for his circular reasoning, and then said he uses it also. I don't know how you can do that. He said that his circular reasoning was transcendental, so therefore his is okay. Well, it's still circular reasoning. Most circular reasoning is transcendental. In other words, appealing to higher things, appealing to God. Most circular reasoning is done by transcendental. In other words, James White, your is not an acceptable circular reasoning. It's just circular reasoning like everybody else does it. And it's a fallacy when you do it, and it's a fallacy when everybody else does it. Yours isn't somehow better because it's James White circular reasoning. It's still a contradiction. So what's going to be talked about is this problem of evil, and it's the Calvinist view of the problem of evil by these guys. I have to re-log in, and we'll try to show the clip. It's about 15 minutes, and I'm going to comment occasionally. I want to get this on YouTube. If this doesn't work out, I'll do it in the studio in my office, where I can have, you know, more notes in place better and stuff like that. But we're going to do it here for the sake of the learning of the body of Christ about Calvinism. So this is Jeff Durbin, and one thing I want to say about Jeff Durbin, even though he has misrepresented me in his blog, and is that okay, Sam? And he's completely, I believe, wrong on Calvinism. I'm going to look at some of his other videos he's putting out. He just put one out before this on predestination, or Calvinism in general, and he's got another one after this on predestination. And I'm going to look at those as well. But this one I want to focus in on because I think it's just fallacy after fallacy. There's three guys in the room. I don't know who they are. Jeff Durbin's their pastor. It's Apologia Ministries. But the thing I wanted to say is I do respect his pro-life ministry. And what he does is he puts feet to his pro-life ministry where he's out on the streets and he's dealing with Planned Parenthood at abortion clinics. And I want to, Calvinist or not Calvinist, say praise God for the work that he's doing there. I think it's if you compare his Calvinism to how he witnesses, I think that you see problems with Calvinism and the way they're witnessing to the people, holding them responsible for evil when they can't do otherwise, because one, it was decreed by God and their sin nature. I think it's contradictory the way he does it, but I don't care, as long as, you know, it's done. And he's bold, and I think he's making way. I've done that ministry. I'm a chaplain, and I've done that ministry, and it's a hard ministry. And it's a very important ministry to stand up for life. So I want to say, you know, God bless you for that. And then, having said that, I might not have so much nice things to say as we look at this video. So, what we need to do is, Calvinists have all of these categories that they speak of. And these categories, we need to understand, though, when they introduce them, they're responsible for what those categories and terms mean. For example, he's going to talk about determinism and the part of determinism that it plays on the problem of evil. And he's also going to talk about compatibilism and explain compatibilism the way that the Calvinists views it, as we are fallen and we are just using our sin nature. I believe they're ultimately contradictory to use them together, and I'm going to show why. Because if you want to use the term compatibilism, you're subject to what it means. You can't just make up stuff about this, all of this things. You're subject to what it means. And, you know, what it means is so important. You can't do the switching of terms. And what I've learned is Calvinists find these terms and put them in their writings even. For example, Calvinists will write about how they're predeterminists and sovereign in all things, and then they'll write about compatibilism, which is a different sovereignty altogether. And they interchange them, but if you're going to use the terms, you're subject to what they really mean. And I don't think that we don't look at the terms to test them to see what they mean, because if we did, we would know that they're breaking rules. They're using contradictory terms. For example, they're Westminster and all the Reformed Confessions of Faith speak about secondary causes and primary causes. Well, if you're going to do that, you're subject to the overall study of efficacy, the study of cause and effect. And they break all the rules of cause and effect, but yet they put in their literature that God's decrees establish secondary causes. And in fact, Matt Slick says in compatibilism, God is not decreeing their causes. And his confession of faith says that they're secondary causes. Why don't you accept your confession of faith that say they're causes? And they play these mysteries because we're not holding them accountable for their terms. Now, I'm also a fan of Leighton Flowers, who's been really good, I believe, at debating Calvinism, debates far better than I do. I don't debate that good. If you ask James White at all, I'm the worst he's ever debated. That's fine. But Leighton Flowers, I'm a fan of. But also, I believe that Leighton Flowers is so worried about using the terms and not misrepresenting them that he actually feeds into their contradictory terms, and we shouldn't accept them at all. I believe Leighton Flowers, he made a video on this yesterday, the same video. He already has put out a video, and the reason I'm doing mine is because I believe that Leighton Flowers shouldn't be using their made-up terms. We need to look at scholarly definitions of these terms and find out what the truth is. I've reached out to Leighton Flowers to talk about this stuff, but he's blowing me off. It's interesting, though, before the James White debate, he was anxious to get a hold of me to warn me about debating James White. And you would think, like, he was reaching out to me as a brother, maybe a friend. And then now that I'm reaching out back to him to talk about, hey, let's maybe be on the same page on some of this stuff, he doesn't return my calls. So maybe I wasn't a friend at all. And I don't know what his motive really was to warn me about debating James White. As if I didn't already know, James White will use tactics that I believe are suspect. And he will bully, and he will do everything he can, I believe, even to the point of dishonesty, I found in my debate. And I don't think we should be catering to their definitions. We need to bust them for using their definitions wrong. And we do that by studying what is determinism. What is, what is compatibilism? What is incompatibilism? They don't talk much about that. It's important. What is theological determinism? And there's different types of compatibilism. There's different types of determinism. And that's what frustrates me a little bit about Leighton Flowers, is he's always using all these different terms for the same thing. In other words, theological determinism, meticulous determinism, and, you know, trying to come up with and then compatibilistic determinism, as if what they're saying is true. I'm not going to buy into their contradiction and say it's true. I don't care if they think I'm misrepresenting them or not. Because we should be calling what they believe predeterminism. And that's what I call it in the debate I had with James White. Because if you hold to predeterminism, you're actually an incompatibilist, and you cannot then say you're a compatibilist, and that's what's going to take place in the video. And I want to get these definitions, a couple of them, out there quickly before we play the video, so that we can point them out when they happen. But for example, there is theological determinism, and this is defined as a form of predeterminism. They're using predeterminism, so I like that. That holds you to a type of determinism, because now you can't be a compatibilist. You're a predeterminist, and not just a determinist. Because when someone, or if Leighton Flowers says, but the determinist, I'm a determinist. So, you know, when he says the determinist believes this, he's speaking of Calvinist. Leighton Flowers is a determinist. He's a soft determinist like myself. But he's granting them, and not wanting to misrepresent what they believe, he's granting them something that is false in saying that it's just the same thing as predeterminism, their compatibilism, which I think is not true. Calvinists are holding to different views in their predeterminism and in their compatibilism. That's why they're wrong. Yes, it is true that it all, when you smash it down, like James White, you know, doesn't want us to smash everything down, but when you smash it down, their view of compatibilism is a type of predeterminism nevertheless. I think what we should do is call them out for using the terms contradictorily instead of saying, validating that their views are correct, because they're not. So theological determinism is a form of predeterminism which states that all events that happened are preordained or predestined to happen by a God, that they are destined to occur given its omniscience. Now, so this is predeterminism. And Calvinists argue this predeterminism all the time. Well, see, these guys argue predeterminism. But what it means is, if God preordains or predetermines everything that happens, the fact that it says, given its omniscience, that means God knows everything. So the fact that God knows everything, that his determinations are going to happen because what God knows, God causes. And that's what predeterminism is in theological determinism. It isn't about the compatibilist free will at all. You see, they're going to use different terms. They're going to use this term when it suits them, and then they're going to change the subject to compatibilism, which is a very different term and a different belief. It's not predeterminism. It's something that's happening in time that our natures are controlling, and they convolute the two as if you can. You can't put them together. They're contradictory. In fact, even before we, so keep in mind, Calvinists believe what God knows, God causes to happen. They'll argue, if God knows you're going to put on a green shirt instead of a red shirt tomorrow, that the fact that he knows it, it was determined. You could not have done otherwise. So it's about what God knows, God causes in their in predeterminism. And I agree with that. I don't hold to predeterminism in all things. I do hold that God has predetermined many things, but not all things, as Calvinists do. So just to call it determinism, Calvinist determinism, it just confuses me, because, well, which determinism are you talking about? Predeterminism? You know, there's different views of what determinism are. Now, I want to introduce a term that's not used by Calvinists that holds them responsible for being wrong in their views on determinism and all the aspects of determinism, and it's called incompatibilism. Now, Calvinists talk a lot about compatibilism, but they don't talk about incompatibilism, because actually, when you compatibilism is no longer predeterminism, thus it is incompatibilism. So what is incompatibilism? Let's look at the definition, so try to explain it. Incompatibilism is the view that a deterministic universe is completely at odds with the notion that persons have free will, that there's a dichotomy between determinism and free will, where philosophers must choose one or other, the other. So if you're not a predeterminist, you cannot be a compatibilist. And that's what I argued in the debate to James White. And I said, you can't be a predeterminist. And he goes, and a compatibilist. And he's over on the other side, yeah, you can. And then I threw in also an open theist, which is a very different view of this subject, which sometimes Calvinists, and they will do it in this video, become actually God is out front of time, restraining things. And that's not predeterminism. They might say that God is predetermined to get out front of time to restrain evil, but that is completely a contradiction. If you just listen to that sentence, you should go, what are you talking about? That makes absolutely no sense. God is predetermined that he's going to get out in front of time and restrain evil? That's not predeterminism anymore. Come on, guys, this is simple. And yet they do it, and no one questions them. They hold to three different views of time. They hold to three different views of how things are determined or how things happen. And all of them are contradictory. And James White says, oh, Steve, you're just trying to smash everything down. That's right, I am. And all apologists, you need to smash everything down because it's called the truth. That's what we do in apologetics. We smash everything down to the truth. And if you only smash it down to, yes, I accept predeterminism and compatibilism, you haven't smashed it down enough, because that's a contradiction. God does not lie. And if you smash it down to the truth, our side is right. But they embrace these logical fallacies. In fact, they hate being called Gnostic, but this is Gnostic in thinking. You have to become unreasonable and illogical to accept these contradictions. And you ought to be smashing them down to the truth. And that's what our view does. We don't hold to these contradictions. We hold to one view of determinism. And actually, I'll try to explain that view. And they hold to these multiple views of determinism. So, that definition, what does it say? It says, incompatibilism is that the view as a deterministic universe. So, determinism, as kind of Leighton Flowers uses it just generically, and then he'll add on meticulous or theological. Any determinism that God's doing is meticulous. Whether he's predetermined it or any predeterminations of God, and I do believe God, and the Bible teaches that God does predetermine, but I don't believe, as Calvinists do, he's predetermined everything, because therefore they cannot be compatibilist. This definition of incompatibilism says if you're a compatibilist, you're an incompatibilist as well. In other words, you cannot be a predeterminist, because it's the view that the determinist universe is at odds with free will. So if they were honest, they would say they're predeterminists sometimes and they're compatibilists other times. This is just illogical. What we need to understand is, for example, predeterminism and which is incompatibilism, they're synonymous. They are also monergistic. In other words, if you're a predeterminist, everything is going to be caused by God, and nothing that happens is not caused by God. This is complete monergism. It's all the act of God, mono meaning only, and it's all God. Predeterminism holds to the incompatibilist view and is monergistic. And you must understand that compatibilism is a synergism. Compatibilism is synergistic. So what I'm telling you is you can't be a predeterminist, which is an incompatibilist, and be a compatibilist. because the word incompatible means you it's not compatible with free will. And they argue all the time, and he'll do it in these verses, God has done everything. And their confession of faith says that God decrees everything that comes to pass, yet not the author of evil, but establishes secondary causes. And then they're subject to the study of efficacy. But their confession says God decrees everything that comes to pass. That means you're incompatibilist. You cannot then say man has free agency or volition, and because compatibilism is incompatible with predeterminism. Predetermined is incompatibilism, so it can never be both. Predeterminism and compatibilism are incompatible. Yet James White, straight in the audience, said mockingly, yes, they're both, we believe both of them. No, it's, you're an incompatibilist if you're a predeterminist, and you're contradicting yourself when you claim to be a compatibilist as well. Predeterminism is involved before time. Things were monergistically predetermined. So God has predetermined everything, and all of their literature says this is what God does in his decrees. He's predetermined. You don't have a free will. So they also have three views of free will that we'll talk about hopefully. But, you know, they'll say you don't have a free will, and then they'll say you do have a free will, but it's just free agency or volition. No, because predeterminism is involved before time, and God predetermined everything from before time, and everything will play out exactly. In fact, they say you have to, you know, you can't believe what we believe because God would have to look about down the tunnel of time and learn. Yet they are compatibilists, which has God synergistically working with people in time and even restraining evil, which is before or after time, he's now restraining. You cannot use those together because they're different views of time. We always hold to the exact same view, and we allow Calvinists to contradict themselves, and we accept it. And we say, we don't want, you know, then they charge us of misrepresenting them. No, I'm not misrepresenting you. I'm representing you perfectly. Your theology is a bunch of contradictions, and it should be rejected for that. It is all circular reasoning. James White admits it's circular reasoning, and it should be rejected for that. Compatibilism is involved in time, God synergistically working in man, thus no longer predeterminism, or what is also defined and synonymous as incompatibilism, which is monergistic. So they don't study that stuff. You never hear that from a Calvinist, otherwise they'd be wrong. And our side doesn't bother to study to call them out on it. When a Calvinist is wrong and you see they have secondary causes written in their literature, you need to study efficacy, and it proves that they do not hold the secondary causes the way they explain them. When they use terms like compatibilism and predeterminism, you need to study it and show that they are wrong. We are not misrepresenting them, they're misrepresenting the truth. These are sciences. You don't want to use... If you want to hold to fideism, which means faith without logic, if you want to hold to that fideism, then, you know, you can, but then take out of your literature that you hold to, you know, that you do hold to logic. Fideism is self-defeating. You have, you know, the term, I don't use philosophy in my religion, is self-defeating. They use philosophy all the time. So, you know, if you don't want it, take this stuff out. Stop arguing it because it's contradictory. And you can have your fideism and make up your own beliefs without any question about philosophy or question about whether it's true based on reason and logic. You can have that, but stop using it and criticizing us for using it, because that's all Calvinism is. It's a philosophy. So they say they're fideist. Oh, don't use any philosophy, but yet, you know, don't use this stuff, these scientific things about Calvinism and compatibilism and incompatibilism and predeterminism. Don't use it then if you just want to be fideist. You do use it though, so now you're accountable and you're responsible for what the terms mean. So keeping these things in mind, let's play the video, and I might stop once in a while, but it's getting long. We want to try to get through this because most people turn off at this point. But we're going to play this Jeff Durbin video on the problem of evil. Alright, here we go.
Not only allow, but orchestrate all of these things together that would lead to this thing happening. Like, what an evil version of God that you believe in. So I think that's why people gravitate towards attacking it so much, is because it really pulls on people's heartstrings. But if you notice, and we talked about this when we started the segment, the assumption within that paragraph is that there's one branch of Christianity that doesn't see what happened to this girl as wrong because of the association of God ordaining all the events of history. Therefore, man cannot be held accountable for his action. It's not something that we should have any, be worked up about, right? That man and his creaturely will, we don't believe that, right? That's the assumption. But we do believe in agency. We do believe that man acts of his own volition, his own fallen volition, nonetheless, because Jesus says whoever commits sin is a slave to sin. Right. And so man chooses in accordance with his fallen volition until that volition is set free by the grace of God to actually do that which pleases God. So
he's talking about the problem of evil. He says we complain because they don't really establish the problem of evil correctly, and we are right about that. And their defense is now, you know, he's saying that they do hold to a free will, but it's a free agency. By the way, a free agency is not free will. A volition is not free will. So they change these terms, and you know, they get away with it. It isn't actually compatibilism. They're talking about the rational spontaneity. That's what we should call it. Because the truth of it is, now they're saying that man chooses his nature. And that's no longer predeterminism. Now they're incompatible with predeterminism, which they hold, and which he's going to argue again. And that's the equivocation that always happens, that they switch from these contradictions, and you don't see them, and you accept them. And actually, I think Calvinists like them. You know, when you see Calvinists use them, they get all, ooh, ah, and it's complete nonsense in my mind. But, you know, Calvinists are somehow impressed with it. Because I believe that they do, they often share how they have a higher knowledge. They used to believe as we did, but they have this higher knowledge. And then they wonder why we call them Gnostics, because that's exactly what Gnostics believe, is you have to have a higher knowledge to understand God. And we're just these, you know, dumb people that don't understand. You're not even using the sciences correctly. I call you out to debate me on the sciences of this, Jeff Durbin. And you won't do it, because you obviously haven't studied it. You're just parroting what you hear from people like James White, who will bully everybody that doesn't accept his contradictions and accuse you of smashing things down, which means I am contradictory. Stop bringing it up. You're just trying to smash it down. And so now he has switched complete concepts. Now he's talking about the fall of man and their total depravity. And he says, we have to talk about that. So the problem with free will in this video is the question is, why as predeterminists that God causally decrees everything that comes to pass? That's what causes are, first and secondary causes. It's in your confession. So he causes by decree everything that comes to pass. And then now you're changing subjects to total depravity and going to argue compatibilism, which is completely incompatible with your first premise. And you're going to argue that this is a logical thing. And it's sleight of hand. When you start to press them, as they admit they get pressed on this, you start to press them on the problem. If God decrees everything, he's causing the evil. And they switch. This is called sleight of hand. They switch. It's called, a red herring means changing the subject. And what they're doing is they're changing the subject, and it's an attempt to, it's a bait and switch. So now they're going to talk about your creaturely free will and compatibilism. And note that we've already seen them at the beginning say, why do they have a problem with us? They don't understand. That's kind of Gnostic, isn't it? You just don't understand us. We were like you, but now we're enlightened. And when you mature, you might be like us. No, I will never be like you because I will never accept your contradictions as true. God is not a liar. He doesn't contradict himself. So now they've already made the switch. And I hope we see, and I can catch and show you, the switches back and forth between the two categories. Let's continue on.
Oh, the assumption is that Calvinists think that someone's not going to be held accountable, or that
that God is making them do things.
Yeah, he's forcing it, right? Yeah, he's forcing that upon them. Yeah. And then I would just point to, you take an example from Scripture like Isaiah chapter 10. God uses the rod of his anger, Assyria.
Okay, go through this, because this needs to be put on.
Okay, so we're going to use his Scripture. People will say, oh, Steve, you're not using Scripture. We'll just use theirs. Because he's, and it doesn't say what they're claiming. It doesn't say compatibilism. I believe that God actually is intervening and in the hearts of the reprobate, which is not a problem. God using the reprobate to accomplish his purposes, which is often they use as, to play out this contradiction, and the contradiction isn't there unless you embrace the contradictory doctrines of grace taught in Calvinism.
On record here, I want you to explain this in detail.
God uses the rod of Assyria to judge his people, right. his people that have sinned against him, that have rebelled against him, that he is actively placing under his judgment. He calls Assyria, this pagan nation, the rod of his anger, right? The rod of his anger.
So this is predeterminism. He's quoting a verse that said God is doing by his hand. So we're going to see this mixture of compatibilism and predeterminism that can't be mixed, but they have no problem doing so.
And Isaiah chapter 10, verse 5, woe to Assyria. So, woe, judgment, divine judgment pronounced on Assyria.
Curse on you.
Yes. Right, on the pagan nation, the rod of my anger. The staff in their hands is my fury. My fury. My fury. It's the mechanism in which I am using you, pagan nation.
Yes.
And you are under my judgment as a result of me doing this. Against a godless nation I sent him, a.k.a. his own people.
Right.
That he's judging. And against the people of my wrath I command him to take spoil, seize, plunder, and to tread them down like the mire of the streets. And this is key.
Okay, hang on. I don't want to interrupt
okay,
you.
No.
Can you just say that last part
Durbin's
again?
Really,
because I'm
going to
get that down on record.
This contradiction.
You brought up my anger. What's he sending them to do against Israel? To judge them?
To judge them. The people of my wrath, I command him to take spoil.
Spoil?
Seize plunder.
Seize and plunder.
To tread them down
tread
like the mire of the streets.
Tread them down like the mire of the streets. Can I ask a question? And please don't forget your thought. Can I ask a question? Are those things painful and awful to think about? Because you gave an example Kwaku, about a horrific example of a wicked, wicked, evil man who deserves to die, and what he did to this young girl, and all the evil, and the slavery, and all the stuff where he just trod her down. You gave a phenomenal example of the evil that's within the hearts of men. But in Scripture here, God is is actually using Assyria as a rod of his anger to do what? To trod these people down in his judgment.
Yes.
And those
his own
are,
people.
So the scripture says God is going to do this through these people. Now, they'll argue it establishes culpability or responsibility. But really, the Assyrians are just a picture, for example, a gun in the hands of God who's pulling the trigger. And, you know, the gun isn't, you know, is a secondary cause in a sense, but it doesn't establish culpability. You don't blame the gun for what they're doing. You blame the one that pulled the trigger, the one that had the free will to pull the trigger. That's who's responsible for the evil. Using the people, and they're going to try to separate God from this, that he's arguing right now, and he's probably going to change it, but he's arguing right now, it's all God. And then now he's going to switch to his volition and compatibilism to explain it. So he's already made a predeterminism statement. He's fixing to work into an income, into a compatibilism argument.
People, by the way.
His own people. Now, please continue, because this gets interesting.
So this is critical, but talking about Assyria, the king, but he does not so intend, and he gives a description of his heart and what's in it.
Yeah.
And his heart does not so think, but it is in his heart to destroy.
Yes.
And to cut off nations, not a few. Right? So we have this description in scripture of the king of Assyria's heart.
Yeah.
His heart is set on doing evil.
Right. But his heart is set on doing evil. Right?
Right.
It's not his intention necessarily to go after Israel.
Right.
But his heart is this wicked, stirred up, evil thing.
So it's not his intention, but God is predetermined that this would take place. And it's not his intention to go after Israel. So God is predetermining it. And now they're going to play this mystery of that makes no intellectual sense on God predetermining it. Now they're going to go into that they were doing it on their own. Now remember, when they start doing it on their own, that's not predeterminism anymore. Because in time, now they're doing all these things, and he's going to say God was restraining them from doing even more evil, and all he had to do is let them go, and God was going to do it. Letting them go, no, God decrees everything that comes to pass. Everything. That includes that not letting them go to freely do what they want to do. He has decreed that they do exactly what they're going to do. That's the difference between compatibilism and predeterminism. Is one is that God can determine something, and a free will can make their own decisions, and God can use the reprobate. Yet what they're saying is God predetermines everything that comes to pass, and now they're going to contradict themselves and say, but they just, now they're doing their own things. And God now, what's he, out of control? He's not causing everything that comes to pass, is the only logical conclusion.
Thing. And what I like to describe when I talk about Isaiah chapter 10, it's like God has Assyria, this rabid dog, on a chain. And it is leaping and biting, and all it wants to do is destroy and to bite and to devour.
And he doesn't realize that he's actually carrying out the purposes of God, the king of Assyria.
Yes.
But in his heart, he does not so intend.
Yes.
He doesn't realize that all of his actions are under the sovereign will of a God that wields history, including his very choices.
So Durbin just contradicted the other guy. Durbin said these people are wanting to do all these things, evidently, that God's not decreeing. They're wanting to just go and do ravenous things, like out of control. And God's restraining them with a leash, which is a different view of time. And the other guy actually says, but they don't even know God's controlling all of this, which would be the literal definition of God tempting man. But nevertheless, we've got to see the equivocation here. This is not, you're either a compatibilist or a predeterminist. Determinism and free will are called compatibilism, but predeterminism and free will are incompatible. You've got to see that. You've got to understand that. And that's what they're arguing. Predeterminism and compatibilism together are incompatible. Thus, the term incompatibilism is born out of predeterminism cannot be compatibilism. Predetermined is incompatibilism. Compatibilism is the view that God, they're logical together, and they're not using them logically. They don't even know what they're doing, but God's controlling it. And this is a pure definition of lack of culpability. You don't know what you're doing. He's even saying they're not even sure they're doing it. They're just doing what they want to do. Yet some outside force is causing them to do exactly what he wants them to do. Their view of compatibilism or rational spontaneity is kind of like a Stockholm syndrome. You know, you kind of, your nature just thinks you're making your own decisions, but really you're under some spell and you do what these outside influences are causing you to do.
God is restraining Assyria's evil until the moment where he's going to judge his own people. He releases the chain.
Predetermines it.
Now, does he make Assyria want to be bad?
Does he
put a gun to Assyria's head and say, Assyria, you need to be evil here for me? Assyria is wicked. It is evil.
That's not what predeterminism says. Assyria, you need to be evil here. Predeterminism says God has decreed everything that comes to pass, that not even a breath you take is not decreed by God. Not even the stopping at the red light is not decreed by God. And now they're backing off. This is called moving the goalpost. They've moved the goalpost now from God decrees everything to come to pass, and now they're feeding you that now they are wanting to... God just says to let them go and they're going to do evil. No, that's a complete contradiction to what predeterminism is. God in predeterminism causes everything every person is doing to the point that it could not have come out otherwise. This is completely ridiculous that God is letting the leash go and their natural evil is going to accomplish this. How does their natural evil know to do exactly what God wants to accomplish? It's not predeterminism anymore, and it's a synergism. Now God is working in man. Predeterminism, God doesn't work in man, letting go of the leash. That's monergism. Synergism is that God is working evil in these guys.
Wants to devour and destroy. All God must do is lift his hand. To let him be evil as he wants to be.
Which
but keep
is
going, because this is where it gets even more interesting.
Just to jump down a few verses, so when all this is said and done,
he's
right,
going to now 12, say determinism.
But when the Lord has finished all the work on Mount Zion and on Jerusalem, he will punish the speech of the arrogant heart of the king of Assyria and the boastful look in his eyes. For he says, by the strength of my hand I have done it, and by my wisdom, for I have understanding. I remove the boundaries of peoples and plunder their treasures. Like a bull, I bring down those who sit on thrones. So what happens after all of this? He uses Assyria in his sovereign will and sicks them on his own people for...
Now he's using our view of sovereignty. That God uses people. He'll use the reprobate. That's what we believe. They criticize us for believing it. And now he's actually using our view of sovereignty, that God releases the boundaries and God just lets them go, and he foreknows exactly what's going to take place. It's no learning that he's doing. He knows exactly what's going to take place in our view of time, and but see, they're playing now our view. This is what we believe.
Judgment, and then he turns right around and holds the Assyrian king responsible, and he says, I'm going to bring the judgment on you. But wait a minute. God, how could anyone resist your will and your purposes of launching this pagan king? Right? How could he...
Now he's back to predeterminism. How could anybody resist your will? Well, that's right. It's a valid question. In predeterminism, you can't resist his will, but you can't also say that they're being let go of the leash. That's not control. That's not permission. That's not anything. That is our view, that God uses the reprobate. He knows if he lets go of the leash what's going to happen, because he knows time, and from the beginning to the end. Even when he delivered up his son, the Calvinist says, God decreed the most wicked act ever in history. No, he didn't. He decreed the most holy act ever in history. Shame on you for saying he decreed the most evil act. All he did in the book of Acts is deliver Jesus up. He didn't have to cause them to do it. He knew if he delivered them up, they're going to crucify him and beat him, and everything will happen just because he delivered him up. That's all it says that God did. And they read into it that God actually is causing their wicked hands to crucify Jesus. The passage says that they do, but our view is the one that they will argue in that circumstance. Our view is that, yes, God delivered Jesus up, and then by their wicked hands they crucified him, and they're held responsible, and it's the most holy act. Not what they were doing. They had no intention of doing holy. They weren't being controlled by God to do holy or decreed by God to kill Jesus. They killed Jesus because they were going to do it. If he was delivered up, they were going to do it anyway. And God is just placing Jesus in time at this exact moment, even causing situations to in the Gospels to not yet. Because God knows the exact time that these things are going to happen, and he delivers them, not controlling everything, which was what predeterminism says.
He know, how could he even resist your will? But then God turns right around and holds that same pagan nation responsible for their actions.
For their sin.
Yeah, for their sin.
Yes. He wants sin, he wants destruction, he wants evil, and for God's own purposes in a fallen world, he has two sinful nations, and God is the one withholding, and he's granting grace and all these different things, and in a moment of God's justice and judgment and discipline, he releases the evil person to do what they want to do, and then God punishes the evil person for the evil that was within them. Let's not forget, this is where Kwaku has no room for this in his theology. Kwaku?
No, he doesn't punish them for the evil that's within them. He punishes them for the evil that when he commands the judgment to take place, he punishes them for the evil that they were doing of their free will. We believe that we do our evil by free will, not by volition or diminished capacity. That they did it by their free will, and that's why they're being held accountable and responsible for their evil. Not because God made them do it, and he holds them responsible anyway when they couldn't do otherwise. All he has to do is deliver up, or he will predetermine in time that judgments occur, but he's not decreeing everything that comes to pass. He even admitted it. He's not decreeing everything that comes to pass. He admitted God's just holding the leash. Not every Assyrian is going to go and do exactly this, which is what they hold in their predeterminism definition of what God knows, God causes. He's letting go of a leash. That's not controlling every person. And it's the equivocation.
It's a fallen world of rebels who hate God. When you paint pictures, emotionally driven pictures of people in the world and this evil and that evil, never forget that the Bible says that we, outside of Jesus, have the wrath of God abiding on us. Mm-hmm. It says that we from the womb go astray. That we are fallen in Adam, hostile towards God, sinners, ungodly, wicked, helpless.
This
That's
is
what
all,
it says. Slaves of sin. We can't outside paint of God's emotionally control. Driven pictures
now
to portray all of humanity as this,
this
neutral people with evil things happening
on our own.
In the world. We are all rebels
outside
against
of
the
God's
king,
decree
each and
because
every
of our
single one of
nature.
Us. And guess what? I, as a reformed person, I would say as a biblical Christian, I have the ability to mourn and demand justice for this young girl who was destroyed by this wicked man because he was doing what his evil heart wanted. However, I refuse to worship a false god that has no control over that.
Exactly it. Yep. On one hand, the god that we believe the scripture teaches is a god that's perfectly sovereign. Everything happens according to his plan, his will, through all time and eternity, and it's all for a purpose.
Purpose.
Right, like you just said.
Sovereign.
The god that he's promoting is one of an infinite number of gods, has no control over what happens. Stuff like this happens, but doesn't happen for a purpose. It doesn't happen for a reason.
God doesn't have control. It's a greater control to know the free will creatures that actually can make choices, not just by diminished capacity, but they can make choices that they know right from wrong, and they do evil anyway. And God is sovereign over free creatures is a much greater sovereignty than he controlling every creature that comes to pass.
Reason. And it promotes hopelessness.
It's a purposeless evil.
And yet.
So now we got this purposeless evil. And James White says this, and, you know, this has always fascinated me, this purposeless evil that they talk about. If God isn't causing everything that comes to pass by decree, it's purposeless. I mean, I can't even fathom the mind that can't think of purpose, God using purpose in evil, if we had our own free wills to do evil, and we made actual choices that we do our own evil by our own free will. It makes no sense, but they, you know, anything James White says, they believe, it doesn't have to make sense. But purposeless evil. So it's purposeless evil if God isn't making it happen. He's going to now go back to the predeterminism, and its purpose has purpose to evil. Purpose to evil. Now we need to remember that if God decrees everything that comes to pass, we know studying cause and effect, that every effect pre-exists in its cause, either as a potential or as an actual. Effects pre-exist in their cause. So the evil that these people are doing, just, you know, out of control, just, you know, ravenous dogs wanting to do evil, this evil, where did it begin? Well, it begins in the mind of God. In Calvinism. Just think of it. They wouldn't even do it. They're just ravenous, you know, dogs that are being restrained. And when the evil occurs, where did it begin? Think about the worst evil you could ever think of. Homosexual rape of a child and dismembering and hiding the body. Let's just go there. Where did that begin? They don't believe it began in the mind of the evil person that did that act. They believe it had to be decreed for it to happen. So where did that evil begin? They're saying that God's mind, he is saying, I'm going to decree the homosexual rape of a child and dismemberment. God, I fear for them, for this theology. That we know that these effects pre-exist in the one that wills it. And God wills by decree these thoughts. Does your God sit and think about dismembering people? And I'm going to bring myself glory by raping a little child? Think of the most disgusting thing. And you, God's sitting there thinking that before the foundations of the world? I'm going to bring myself glory? Where did the evil begin? Begins with God. Of course God's the author of evil in this definition. It says in their decrees, yet not the author of evil. That's another lie. Because it begins, they wouldn't have even thought it. They weren't being let go. God decrees everything that comes to pass. And so every murder, every rape, James White says, if it wasn't God decreeing it, it's purposeless. Well, it also means that evil's an attribute of God. There's no darkness in God at all, it says in 1 John. Yet darkness begins in the mind of God and acts out on his people only by volition. They didn't even choose it. It's acted out by God on them. It's their rod. It's God's rod acting upon them. And they don't talk about the rape of a little girl in these scenarios. They talk about, oh, he took a rod and he, you know, killed some people. Well, war happens all the time like that. But when you start to think about the heinous things and the gross things that happen in this world, they began in the mind of God. From your mouth, Jeff Durbin, to God's ears. That's a wicked thing to think. And we're going to wrap it up, but I wanted him to say this one other thing. We see the equivocations. It's compatibilism, it's predeterminism. It's the nature, it's predeterminism, which it's synergism, it's monergism. Contradictory.
Yet, as we've also demonstrated, we've just gathered the meaning from Scripture. What it teaches is that God still holds people accountable for their evil actions, although he wields all of history.
Mm-hmm.
That God uses to accomplish his will, even God though they have no idea that they're actually doing so, he still holds them accountable.
He didn't give them those evil desires.
Right.
It was within their hearts to do it, and they acted freely with their agency based upon their nature.
No, they just said over and over, God decreed it, and then they turn around in the next breath and say, God didn't make them do it. Oh, so they could have done otherwise. And we already defined theological determinism and is if God knows it, God causes it. That's predeterminism. That's theological predeterminism. If God knows it, God causes it. He can't learn it. Therefore, yes, he either had to, as a predeterminist, cause and put them and make them do it, or they did it from their own free will or volition. Which is it? It's not both. It's one or the other. Quit playing paradoxes and mysteries and circular reasoning, because God is truth, and in him there is no darkness at all.
So this is where it's really important. I did not create this myself. It was from a pastor a long time ago, but it's
after
one of the best ways that
this
I've ever thought of describing this. And that is to say, and I've used it a lot, so for those of you guys that are new listeners, in terms of our nature being the foundation of our will, like our will is free, well, our will is enslaved to our natural state, which is fallen or regenerated. So we're either fallen and our will is operating based upon a fallen nature, or we're regenerated, alive from the dead, and our will now is operating on the basis of an alive spiritual nature. So one of my old pastor friends used to say, if you were to take a pile of meat, and you put a vulture into a room with a pile of meat and a pile of carrots. Now, if you leave the room, shut the door behind you, leave the vulture in there with the meat and the carrots, which pile will the vulture freely choose?
The carnivorous pile.
You already know, because by nature, it's going to choose the meat. It's not going to go for the carrots. But now change the scenario, and you put a rabbit into a room with a pile of meat and a pile of carrots, what will the rabbit freely choose? Well, based upon what its nature is. It's going to go for what its nature is. Now, take a sinner against a holy God, fallen, right? Put him in a room and have God on one side and their sin on another. What will they freely choose? Not God.
Right.
Freely. They don't want him. Their nature determines the activity of the will. Now, take a regenerated person who's filled with the Spirit of God, who now is redeemed and saved.
Their nature determines the act of the will. I thought the decrees of God, he decrees everything that comes to pass. Causally, because remember, secondary causes means God's the primary cause. He causally decrees everything that comes to pass, and now the switch we just heard.
put them in the room with God and their sin, what are they going to go for? Well, they're going to now have new affections. They're going to freely want God, right? So that's in terms of the will and our choices. But let's go to some scripture real fast here. Psalm 135, 6. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and...
Whatever he pleases, he does. In other words, whatever God knows, he does. Back to predeterminism.
And in earth, in the seas, and in all the deeps. I think that covers just about everything, don't you? In
everything.
The heavens and on earth.
Not compatibilism.
In the seas and in
everything.
All the deeps. The Lord does all that he pleases. Not the Mormon God.
I wonder if Kolob's included in that.
I think it was. I mean, in the heavens, right? But our God is in the heavens, Psalm 115:3. He does whatever he pleases. That's not the Mormon God. That's not the Mormon
now
God.
Now they're back to God's
predeterministic
sovereignty.
Would it please the Mormon God to stop all evil in the world? Would it please the Mormon God? Do you think? Quaker would probably say, well, yeah, I think maybe he would want to do that. Well, according to Scripture, the God in the heavens does whatever he pleases. He should be able to stop all these things
if he
didn't want them
to
happen.
They let go the
in other words, in Kwaku's perspective, please hang on here. In Kwaku's perspective, you have a perspective of a God who doesn't know.
So I'm going to stop here. He talked about how impressed he was about... the person that told him about the ravenous dog, it's going to always choose to eat the meat. This means that he doesn't, he's not choosing by God's decree. He's choosing by his desires, which is the contradiction. And he talks about how impressed he was when someone told him that. And I must admit that my flesh is also attracted to the Calvinist doctrine of total depravity with their synergism of compatibilism. The way it's used in Calvinism, because it's a diminished capacity. We don't hold ravenous dogs morally responsible for eating meat. So what they're doing is they're diminishing their responsibility by saying, we were just humans doing our nature, and we were just doing, you know, we just loved meat. We're going to always eat meat. I bet you're attracted to that, Jeff Durbin, because it's attractive to the flesh. I remember in jail, and I've been in jail, and I've been a chaplain going to jails, and I have a lot of experience. I oversaw a men's home of people coming out of jail to be reacclimated to the world. And I've always talked to these people, and the people that are in jail, it's always an outside circumstance for why they did what they did. It was the neighborhood I grew up in. It was my spouse was tempting me. It was my nature. It was all these things, and they would never accept responsibility for them doing the evil of their own free choice, because there was always some diminished capacity that they would rely on to not accept responsibility for what they do. Most people in jail are like that. There's two ways of diminished capacity. One is that you have a nature in such a way that you only want to do evil. That's diminished capacity. That gets you off the hook if you use, a court system. And it's attractive to say, I did it because I was high. I did it because I couldn't help myself. God, decreed it is a fair thing to say too, because that's diminished capacity as well. So the diminished capacity is because they're slaves to their nature. And it's diminished capacity because God caused it to happen and they couldn't have done otherwise. So I bet you like it. I bet you were fascinated. But all humans are responsible because we are image bearers of God. And we, by free will and sound mind and body, have chosen rebellion against God. Our side will not be found guilty as having attempting to diminish our responsibility in evil, as Calvinism does. We will not be found using our evil as decreed or merely just blame shifting that I was decreed and had diminished capacity. we will be found having a godly sorrow that leads to repentance. I'm here to confess, of sound mind and body, I did all of my evil acts and I belonged in jail. And when I repented, I admitted not as any excuse, no excuses. I finally stopped and admitted that I did of my own sound mind and body, and I put myself on the mercy of God and the mercy of the court. And I'm not going to be found in heaven saying, God, you decreed it. My sin nature just made me do it. No, I'm going to be found not as the Calvinist, but I'm going to be found having taken full responsibility for my evil. I'm not blaming. I know what it's like on the streets. If you blame someone on the streets for something you did, you'd be quiet if they helped you do it, because you're bringing them in to your crime, and you'll get killed on the streets if you do that. These guys, you know, they got their beards, they think they're tough. Durbin's brave to do his sidewalk ministry, I believe, but he's not willing to take full credit for his evil, and it's called blame shifting. James White said he addressed this when I did my video on him, freedom to blame the potter. He says, we've never written down that we blame God, as if that's, it's still diminished capacity. It's still, God did it. I didn't do it on my own. God let the leash go. Or it was my nature. James White said, I told him that blames God for evil. He says, we've never written down anywhere in history. That video made no sense, the rebuttal to my video of freedom to blame the potter. Made no sense. But the only thing I got out of it was, he said, we've never written that down. No theologian has ever written down that we blame God for our evil. Of course it's not written down. In Calvinism, when they're blaming God, guilty people try to cover up their crimes, not write them down. It's the logical conclusion of what you believe. And you're going to have to give an account. I can honestly say I'm not claiming credit for salvation. I'm accepting full responsibility for my evil, and I'm not blame shifting by putting it on other things. And these guys with passion are blame shifting, and I've seen it in jail over and over, and it never works. Total repentance and total acceptance of responsibility is what God wants from us. This video is an attempt at free will theology, but they don't believe in free will. They believe in volition. That's no such thing as free volition theodicy. Theodicy is we're taking free will as it's our sin. You played no part in it, God. Mm-hmm. Not ex nihilo, as Leighton Flowers said, we do evil ex nihilo. No. We do it out of things that are in creation, and the choices and laws that God has placed, and our conscience bears witness to God's laws, and we rebel freely. I'm not responsible because I can only eat raw meat and I'm a carnivore. I'm responsible because I could choose to do otherwise and I did the evil instead. This isn't a free will theodicy. They don't believe in free will. Remember, predeterminism excludes free will. And then compatibilism tries to include it, but it's not free will, it's free volition. He even said, it's not a true free will, it's agency and volition. You don't believe in a free will agency or a free will theodicy. I'm calling you to accept responsibility for your sins. Calvinists say, I don't know how I'm responsible. If your theology has you saying you don't know how you're responsible, you need to repent and rethink your theology, because you're going to stand before a holy and perfect God and implicate him in your evil. It needs to be stopped. So we've seen this is a bunch of equivocations, contradictions, moving the goalpost, red herrings, which means changing the subject, fall, predestination, which are incompatible. And they're trying to make their position unfalsifiable, taking contradictory terms. It's all circular reasoning. 1 Corinthians 2, their view is circular reasoning.
They're trying to make it harder for
you. Got to be saved before you can be saved. Irresistible grace is circular reasoning. You have to be irresistibly saved before you can understand the Bible, and it starts from a circular argument. It's all circular and contradictory, and what are people doing? Why aren't we defending this? So let's close and let's pray.